that, so we want to do that. So basically, want to have a kind of very interactive discussions where, you know, I'll probably just be asking questions and you guys have to answer them. Fine? Yeah. So let me just introduce myself. My name is okay, and I did make slides for this talk, but you know, there's no projector, so I'll just share it on the website. So, you know, if anybody wants to you know, have a look at it later on, you know, you're free to do that. Okay. My name is Pavan Verma, and you know, you don't need to note anything down because all this is in the slides. And this is my email address. Currently, I am a technology entrepreneur. I've started my own IT services and products company focused on cloud computing and web applications. Before that, I was a software architect at NetApp for 5+ years. I did, you know, kind of at NetApp, a systems company, storage company. We were always thinking about, you know, the things that we are going to discuss in the next 40-45 minutes. So just wanted to start off, you know, when I've when I was thinking about, you know, what I wanted to talk about, you know, there was something that happened in December, around December 24, 25th, that set a, you know, good context around that. And, you know, that's how I've actually phrased, you know, introduced my talk in the website. So anybody wants to talk about that? Anybody who's read my talk description on the website? There was something about Netflix and...
Services were down for 1 month on the Christmas sale.
Okay, so what happened exactly? So what happened? What happened with Netflix?
So if services were down on the day of the Christmas and the traffic was going up, it was supposed to go up, but at the same time, not many people, customers were able to use the Netflix services. So I think issue was found on the Amazon site itself, nothing to do with the Netflix. I'm not sure, but probably something to do with the ELB, something going on, apart from this, I don't know.
Okay. So, yeah.
They should have all the power.
Right. So, Netflix service. So, what is Netflix, by the way? Anybody? What is Netflix? Video streaming service. So, in the US, you know, the bandwidth is now so, you know, good that videos are streamed over the internet. So Netflix is the number one video streaming service. Earlier, you know, about 5-7 years, 10 years ago, it started out as a CD or DVD distribution service. So you used to, instead of going to a DVD rental shop, you can order DVD rentals on Netflix website and they'll post it to you. But in the last 4-5 years, it has now moved into video streaming. So instead of shipping the DVD physically, they just stream it over the network, internet. Right? So it's December 24th. Everybody is, you know, taken off, part holiday mode. And what do people do on December 24th? So it's like Diwali for us, right? Diwali or, you know, whichever your festival is. So people want to spend time with the family, right? And the way they spend time with the family is many people watch movies, either on Christmas Eve or on 25th. And Netflix service goes down. So think about, like, Flipkart service goes down on Diwali day. So it's a major loss for Netflix, right? Now, what happened? You know, it happened because of some failures in their data center. And their data center was, they were using Amazon Web Services, which is the, you know, the number one cloud hosting platform. And we'll talk about the specific failures, some failure. Okay, so want to talk about what kind of failures can happen in a data center? So, you know, there was a data center failure. Let's think of, so, you know, one thing I was, you know, when I was thinking about, you know, this topic is that, how is the, you know, this topic of failures and recovering from failures and all, it's a very dry topic. It's not a fancy UI or a fancy mobile app or a fancy, you know, gadget where you can control your, you know, that leap device, things like that. It's not fancy. It's a very dry, somewhat dull topic. Why is it relevant to you guys? So anybody, you know, and anybody thinks that handling data center failures or the topic of data center failures is relevant to you? Why?
Irrespective of the product that you talk about, everything is powered by the infrastructure.
Okay, so a friend here is saying that it's relevant because I have hosted my application or my e-commerce site or whatever on the infrastructure. If the infrastructure fails, there was no use of making the application in the first place, right? Fine. Okay, so you know, let's put it in some more. Okay, now let's say if you were a business, right? What does a failure mean to you?
Loss of revenue.
Okay, so let's start listing these things down, right? What is the impact of a failure or the cost of a failure? Okay, what else? So I'll just say, I think both of you are same thing. Okay. Make sense? So, you know, if my application is not available or if my e-commerce site is not available, I lose revenue. So if it's unavailable for one day, I lose revenue for one day. I lose customer credibility. What else? Kind of here, brand value. Loss of data. Can you give me an example?
If I didn't create a replica of some customer sensitive data, maybe some phone number or something, which is required for the day-to-day shopping, I cannot go to customer and ask for those records.
Yeah, so let's say I gave an order to Flipkart at 10 a.m. and at 10 a.m. and 15 minutes, the server crashed. Measures, they might lose my order, so which is data, right? Or let's take another example. Let's say I have filed a customer support ticket with some site. Again, if they don't take any preventive measures and if the application goes down, my support data has got lost. And there could be, you know, different types of data. Whatever data you want to imagine, you can imagine. Okay. What else? If my site is down, what will the customer do? He'll go to somebody else, right? So there's a, you know, I lose credibility and I also lose business, you know, there is a lost business opportunity. Which could be the lost business opportunity, could be a loss of revenue, or it could be something different. Right? Okay, now you are an employee. So let's say you're an employee of, you know, some company, and the servers of your company go down because of which you lose data. Then how do you feel? Do you feel nice that, huh?
Satisfaction factor goes up.
You feel frustrated, right? So, the way I look at this, these are the tangible costs. So these, you can measure reasonably easily. And these are the intangible costs. Make sense? Can you guys see the board? Okay. Now let's take a business and estimate the loss of revenue. You know, let's put it in dollar terms. So anybody wants to volunteer, pick a business and let's figure out what, you know, how much loss it will be. Anyone? Volunteer?
I made a calculation. Let's say it's a Google. $50 million company. Let's say everything comes online. And if 1 minute, if it goes out, it's something like 50 lakhs of revenue.
Okay. So it's Google revenue is 50 billion.
Yeah.
Right? $50 billion. Right? Per year. And then you want to calculate in terms of 1 minute.
1 minute is 50 lakhs.
Okay, so we divide by 365 into 24 hours into 60 minutes. So I don't know, we have to do this calculation.
Yeah, that's 50.
But what he's saying, we'll believe him. So this is rupees 50 lakhs per minute. Okay, how much is this per day? Or so this multiply by 24. It's 1200.
16.
Ah. Yeah, roughly. Okay. So Google is a giant company, but let's take maybe a smaller example. Dropbox. Okay. So do you know what is the, so how would you calculate the loss of revenue for Dropbox for, let's say, 1 day? If Dropbox service was down for 1 day. Although Dropbox is not a good example, I think, because Dropbox, they bill every month, right? So I think let's take a e-commerce site. The e-commerce site is a classic, very good example, because if you've lost the revenue, your customer, there's a good chance your customer is going to some other site. Yatra. Any idea what is Yatra's revenues per year? Want to take a guess? That's too low. 1.5 crores per year? Okay, let's assume that. So Yatra? So I don't know how we've calculated, but let's say rupees 1.5 crore per day. So if Yatra's application was down for 1 day, a friend is saying that Yatra will lose business of 1.5 crores per day. Is this a relevant amount for Yatra? Okay, but it may not be there for Wiki, on the Wiki, because Yatra is a private company. Yeah, but the thing is that, are these amounts small? Are they trivial to ignore the matter? Or are they big enough to, so that we have to pay attention to them? Make sense? How much? 670 billion. With a B, right? So how many crores is that? And this per year, right? No. 370 billion rupees. For that, if you can tell me why is handling failures relevant to you, then I can jump. But you have to first tell me. Otherwise, I cannot jump. So why is handling failures relevant to you?
Revenue mostly is like, let's say, for the English, like, let's say, downside is where the X amount of money is going to cost, we're calculating that, okay, fine. In this age of, you know, where this whole application, where the social noise, whether it's active or inactive, we don't know whether it gets amplified or social network. I mean, where it costs like over time, let's say DevEx, 500 or 1000, that is a very more important.
Right.
So that is why we need to, like, let's say, the
minimizes that delta x close to zero. So I mean, so that is understood. But why again? Like you said, can we
not jump there? Because
it's I mean, this is a gigantic amount. Even if it's not gigantic, losing the customer base, which would switch on to the next side. But we never know if he or she is going to back. Unless we, because he or she is going to jump ship, and let's say is being provided good service, and is constantly being fed with social media data that says that, okay, at this point in time, this artist was there at this site, so why should I go with them? So that is that criticality is always there. But but from a technical perspective, like you said, can we not jump to...
Right. So, I want to come to one more point. And then we can start jumping. So I think one point very relevant that he said is that in today's day and age, the intangible cost, which is actually quite hard to measure, may be much more than the tangible cost. Because your intangible cost occurs over long term. You know, once you've lost credibility, you may have lost that customer for life. And that customer may give you a bad brand name among his friends. So you may not lose only one customer, you may lose that customer and his friends, right? This is what you were saying. Cool. Now, the other point is that if I was Yatra and if I knew that this is what the cost of failure for me is, how much will I be willing to spend to make sure that my infrastructure never fails? But at least, you know, it's so basically I'll be willing to spend somewhat of the order of magnitude of the loss of revenue, right? So, and these are huge amounts. So the thing is that companies are willing to spend a lot of money, at least big companies, you know, big. So who has this problem? Who is, you know, who's gonna lose credibility or brand? A big company. A small company doesn't care that much, you know, but for a big company, the cost of intangible loss is very, very high. So, so in terms of dollar or rupees, there's a big amount of money that companies are willing to spend to make sure that their infrastructure is not going down. And this, you know, the kind of the industry that I come from, which is, you know, systems kind of thing, like, you know, companies like NetApp, EMC, Oracle, they have been making billions of dollars in this industry, IBM. Okay, so now we have the motivation for our talk and we can go ahead. So I want to talk about what types of failures can happen. So let's just, you know, list down what failures you think can happen. So when I'm hosting my e-commerce site in a data center or in the cloud, what kind of failures can happen? Network outage. So what does it mean? What failed?
It can be even the ISP provider, ISP providers can fail. Anything can fail. Maybe the network within the data center can fail.
Yeah, so give me one by one. So ISP, my internet link failed, right? Okay, what is?
Network inside the
What does it mean? Network inside means?
Routers.
Routers, switches, cables. Yeah, we'll come to... Okay, that's it. Anyone else?
Hardware failure.
Hardware, what hardware?
Server, storage.
Server, what's server is a lot of things.
Processor,
okay. So, processor, RAM. you know, other motherboard and other hardware in the server. Okay. Disks are the probably the number one reason for failure. They are like infamous for failing. Okay, what else? Powers. So what does it mean? Power means like when will electricity outage. So has it ever happened? Can you give me an example? Which floods? Sandy? Okay, something. So, I mean, I'll just assume whatever you guys are saying. So power outage. What else? Human error. Huh? What does it mean? Crash why? Software bugs or misconfiguration because of human error. Okay. Sorry? Sorry? Flood. Yeah, but what will happen in a flood? Okay, data center was flooded. Okay.
And malware, virus, which comes into the server, it can remove your data.
Okay, bugs or viruses. Nice one. Cooling air. So, air conditioning. What will happen if we switch off the air conditioning in the data center? They can melt. So, anyone wants to add anything? Make sense? Okay. So now. If the software is not designed to handle load, maybe it can crash. Fine. So there's a whole variety of failures. Okay. So now I wanted to discuss three or four specific techniques to deal with failure. Okay, but before that, failures will happen. You know, data centers will try to design themselves so that failures happen less frequently, but they will happen. Do you guys agree? Why? Because they've been happening over the last 5 years, right? So, we cannot just say that I'll design an ideal data center which doesn't have any of these. That is a kind of a idealistic view. That's not, you know, it's not realistic at all. At least in today's generation of technology. Fine. So does everybody accept that failures will happen? So to prevent the kind of losses that we've seen earlier, we should be doing something to handle failures. Make sense? Okay. And again, just want to recap. What was the two? So we discussed two tangible costs of failures. So what were those two tangible costs of failures? Loss of revenue and loss of data, right? And why is loss of revenue happening? Why did I lose business in that particular time? Downtime. What was down? Application was down. So, one, application was down. Second, I lost data. So those are the kind of the, at a high level, those are the two impacts of failure. So you know, that's what we need to deal with. So let's start with loss of data. So if I want to prevent loss of data, what do I do?
Backup.
Okay. So, backup, replica, and somebody said synchronous backup. That actually, I don't know what that means.
Before you complete transaction, you get acknowledgement. Your primary side as well as your backup side is aware of the synchronous backup.
Right. So I think there's a different word that I'm going to use for that. So we'll come to that. Okay. Okay, but what does backup mean? Again, you're replacing one term with another. What does backup really mean? At a very simple, in simple words. So I make another copy of the data and store it somewhere else. Now, so there are a few things important here, but I think we'll come to that later. But basically, it's making a copy of your data and storing it, and so that if there's a failure, then what will we do?
We'll restore the data.
We'll restore the data. Okay. So is copy of data. And we can restore it in case of failure. Okay, so because we can restore it, we will not have we'll not lose the data. Okay. Now the problem with backup is that so let's say this is time. So let's say this is 10 a.m. This is 11 a.m. and so on. Okay. So let's say I did a backup at 10 a.m. Okay, and there was a failure at 11 a.m. Okay, what about the data between 10 and 11?
It's lost.
Make sense? So, backup reduces the amount of loss of data, but it's not zero. And we'll come to we'll come to a term that a technical term for this, but it's not zero. Okay. Right. So can you just hold on to that thought, because I want to introduce those terms later on. Those are the terms I want to introduce, but later on. Okay. Now there are. Where do I back up?
Tapes.
Okay. Tapes or. What kind of storage?
I guess he's talking about DSP. Typically, you don't the data. If you want to archive, you can have the data. If it is, what the data is being
stored. So, where should I store it?
What is the storage
box? What is that storage box? That sandbox is made up of what? It's made up of disks, right? So, it's basically I can back up to either tape or disk. Okay. Does everybody know what is a tape? A tape is, very similar to your audio cassette tape. You know, it also has a tape. It's a magnetic thing. and it's not random access. So does everybody understand random access and sequential access? Sure? Okay. So this is called disk to tape backup and this is called disk to disk backup. Now, what are the properties? What does disk to disk mean, and what does disk to tape mean, and what does disk to disk mean?
Disk to tape, when you're moving data from your existing SAN drive or local hard drive to tape, it is DVD, and from disk to disk, we said SAN to DVD.
Yeah. So let's talk about, you know, cost. Which one is expensive? Which one is cheaper?
Tape is cheaper. This also people for low RPM.
Yeah, but I think still, tape is cheaper, and this is, you know, costlier.
So your cost depends only on the storage type.
Yeah, all those are there.
But only depends on the tape.
Right, but so there are, you know, there are tape controllers which will take the data, back it up, and there are again storage backup software that will back up to disk. Let's talk about which one will be faster to restore.
D to D.
Why?
Tape speed is the data transfer speed is very slow.
Yeah, so I'm not sure if that answer is always correct, but because the property of tapes is that tapes have very good sequential read speed. So, you know, to find a particular point in the tape is very difficult, but if you just want to stream data from the tape, it's pretty fast. So if you want to restore everything, both are good, but if you want to restore, let's say, just one file. You know, for example, let's say you lost one file because of human error. So you don't want to store everything. You just want to store one file. Then disk is much better. Okay. So this may be slightly faster, and this may be slower. The other advantage of disk is that you can keep the data online. Depending on your objectives. If your objective is, normally you'll just say I'll back up this data set using tape, and I'll back up the other data set using disk. It's not really based on what is the quantum of change. Okay, want to come to one more thing? In disk, your backup data is online or can be kept online, right? Because your disk can be attached to a storage box and they can serve data. And there may be value in that. So any value that you see with backup data? So one is that if the data is online, it may be faster to restore it, right? Another thing is that you could run analytics on it. You know, because a lot of time analytics are not run on the primary data set, they are run on the backup data set, because so that the primary data set performance is not affected. Make sense? So this is a comparison of disk to tape and disk to disk backup. Okay. Now we'll come to, so this was at a very kind of a little abstract level. Backup in AWS. So how does backup happen in the cloud or in Amazon Web Services? Yeah. So how is an AMI backed up? Right. Kind of. Not really. I mean, at least I don't know of any tool to do that. Anybody heard snapshots? What is a snapshot? Yeah, so I think both of you were right. So it's a point in time or a photograph of your data taken at a particular time, and this you can take a snapshot of your data and store it somewhere. Okay, and then if required, you can restore from the snapshot. So snapshots are point in time copies of data. Is backup all? Does backup have to be point in time? Okay. Do you guys understand the word point in time? So, point in time means that let's say I have a huge drive. Let's say 1 terabyte drive. Point in time means I'll take a snapshot at that particular second, and I'll get the exact state of that drive at that particular second. Versus a backup doesn't need to be point in time, because a backup may start at 10 a.m. and finish at 11 a.m. So the things that were modified between 10 a.m. and 11 a.m., you don't know. They may have been backed up, they may not have been backed up. So because a backup is, it's neither a point in time copy of 10 a.m. and it's neither a point in time copy of 11 a.m. Make sense? Sure? Okay, and somebody was talking about replicas or redundant copies. So replica is a copy. Again, it's another name for the copy. So in AWS, it takes replicas of objects in S3. So if you store any object in S3, Amazon doesn't store just one copy, it stores 3 or 4 copies of that. So that even if one copy is not available, you can access from a different copy. Okay. So these were things about backup. Okay, now we're going to talk about, so this was about how we can at least minimize our loss of data. Now we get back to the other point. The other point was that the application itself may be down. Snapshot is at a file system. At least I don't know of an equivalent term. Snapshot will be at a file system level. So there is something called high availability, which will help my application not go down. Okay. So what does high availability mean? It basically means that the application will be able to service requests. I mean, which means that the application will be available in spite of some failures in the environment. Okay, so we'll come to some specific examples. The most prevalent notion of high availability in the industry is something called no single point of failure. What this means is that your application doesn't have any single point of failure, which means that it can handle failure of any one component. So for example, no single point of failure means, let's say disks, it can handle any particular disk is not a will not lead to failure of the application. But if two disks go down, your application could go down. So this is the most prevalent notion, and why? Because what's been observed is that the probability of two components going down or failing at the same time is very, very low. Make sense? Yeah. So even if your application has no single point of failure, that's good enough. That's okay. That's at least like a bare minimum. Okay, and how is high availability achieved? There are basically two things to do high availability. One is you need to have redundancy in the system. The other thing is you need to be able to switch over to the redundant component. Okay, so I'll give you an example. So one of the it's not mentioned here, but one of the reasons for failures is power supplies. Power supplies are again notorious for going down. Power supplies, you know, in a server, that's the component which provides power to the server, DC power. So all, you know, reasonable servers have at least two power supplies, so that if one goes down, the other one can serve power. Okay, so that is the redundancy. And then a second one is, like we were talking about S3 having multiple copies of data. So if one copy is down, you can still kind of switch over to the next copy. So that's also kind of you need this to have high availability. Okay. There are two modes of high availability. One is called active-active. And the other one is called active-passive. So anyone wants to take a guess what this is?
Active-active, both the nodes or both the things will be available at the same time. One in the second situation, one will be passive, and it will kick in with the first one.
Yeah. So just one correction. So both the components will be available means both can serve data. So let's say if I have two servers, in active-active configuration, both can serve data at the same time. In active-passive, one will be serving data and the other one will just be a dumb standby. It's not serving data. Only when the primary one fails, the secondary one will become active. Make sense? Okay. In the slides, there's a reference architecture for high availability setup in Amazon Web Services. So it's there in the slides. I think, you know, I'll suggest have a look at that, because running out of time, so just want to cover something called disaster recovery. So disaster recovery, as the name suggests, is recovering from some kind of a disaster. Okay, so a disaster is a very major, something very major, where maybe it can be as bad as your whole data center, somebody said flooded. So that's a good example of a disaster. Your whole data center went down because it was underwater. Or there was I was in the US in 2003, and there was this thing called the Northeast grid failure in US, where I was in Michigan. There was a region in the north, Midwest of US and Canada, where there was no power for 2 days. So if there's a data center in that region, it'll not have power. So that's again a disaster, right? So a disaster is kind of it's a very rare occurrence, but it's from a business planning or business continuity point of view, it's the worst kind of scenario. You know, just think your whole data center is gone, right? So how do you safeguard against disasters? So basically, I need to have another setup, same setup, but in a different geo. A different geo means a different geography. Because why different geography? Because that geography will not be impacted by that disaster, because disasters are localized to a particular geo. So let's say if I was running my application in California data center, I can have a disaster recovery setup in the Singapore region, so that if the California data center goes down, I can switch over to the Singapore region. Okay, now next step. How do I actually maintain such a setup? How does load balance help? Yeah, but where was your load balancer? Where will you have this load balancer? So recursive, recursive thing. Yeah. But you know, in terms of the cloud, a very simple setup is to replicate. You know, involves two steps. One, replicate your data, and be ready to bring up your servers in case of disaster. So two steps: replicate data to different geo. Okay, so let's say we were talking about California to Singapore. Okay, and second step is that in Singapore, I should have my setup ready to take over. Ready to start. So that if the California data center goes down, my Singapore setup becomes up. And the third thing I need is that my application traffic was going to California. I have to reroute it to Singapore. So for example, simple cases, domain name service. I might, you know, this might have a name IP1, this is IP2. I have to change my DNS to map the site name from IP1 to IP2. So I have to redirect traffic to the new site. Amazon AWS doesn't give you tools to manage this. You know, that's kind of one market gap we've seen. It doesn't really give you tools to manage this. Just one more point. When we say replicate data, what data are we talking about?
Database.
Okay. Good. All data. Basically, my database data, but also, you know, if you take an e-commerce site as an example, my photos, my videos, my application code itself. So, whatever data I need to restart the application on the other side. Now, last thing we come is, just bear with me a couple of minutes. So, recovery point objective and recovery time objective. So, recovery point means, how much data loss happened. So if I had a failure, and if I, you know, let's say I had a backup restore, if I did a restore, how much data did I lose? So that is my recovery point.
Will I lose or I lost,
either way. Okay, and recovery time is, how much time did it take to recover from the failure? Okay, so let's say in terms of backup restore, how much time did it take to restore from the failure? Is the next presenter here? You're next? Just give me 2 minutes. I'm just wrapping up. So, right? So recovery point is, how much data will I lose, or, you know, I did lose when I recovered from the failure. And recovery time is, how much time did it take to recover from the failure? And for both of these metrics, what is good? Low or high? Low values or high values?
Low values.
Everybody sees that? Low values are good. So ideally, I don't want to lose any data. So I want my recovery point to be zero. And I want the recovery to happen instantaneously. So I want my recovery time to be zero. So low values are good for both of them. High values are bad. And these are, in enterprise or, you know, in infrastructure planning, these are normally used with a O, which means recovery point objective, recovery time objective, because when you plan it with a certain objective. Like, I think, as you were saying, that how much will I lose? So it's a kind of a planning thing. So normally you'll see these terms are more common, RPO and RTO. Okay. Now, let's say, backup. What is the RPO and RTO of backup? Backup restore. So this is a quiz for you guys. You know, how much were you, who was sleeping, who was not sleeping?
RPO will be, again, it depends on the type of backup which you are scheduling. It's hardly scheduled.
that comes in, you might not have a high RPM. The RPM will be on medium extension. RPO will be again based on the database. It's complete database, complete restore, then it might be, but you might be.
Right.
Snapshot again,
RPO
will be low,
RPO
will be also low.
Okay, so first let's understand snapshot. Do we understand why is RPO low in snapshot? So in snapshot, I'm taking a point in time copy of the file system. So let's say I can take a point in copy every 5 minutes. Can I take a backup every 5 minutes? Normally I cannot because transfer that data so fast and it also impacts system performance. So for backup restore, like at least the way I'll put it is that this is high. And for snapshot, both of these are low. What about high availability? So recovery point is low because there's actually your application is never down. Yeah, the presenter is here. Okay, I'll be done in a minute. And for DR, it kind of varies. Yeah, so I think as a conclusion, what have we discussed? We've discussed, what are the kind of failures that can happen at a data center? Why are they relevant to you as a business or as a developer of such applications or as a, somebody who maintains such applications? What are the key issues with failures? Basically, it's the unavailability of the application and the loss of data. And the techniques to handle failures, which is the three techniques, backup, high availability, and disaster recovery, which have different characteristics. And we discussed these important terminologies, recovery point objective and recovery time objective. Okay. And with this, thank you very much. Sorry for the delay and wish you a great Barcamp Bangalore 13. Thank you.